Oh, I was born first.
One second.
And he came after me.
Okay.
He came after me.
One second.
Wait.
That's all right.
So my name is Gerd Korman. The documents call me Adolf Gerd Korman. The Hebrew documents refer to me as Avram Gershon Korman. They all amount to the same thing. So I was born on July 24th, 1928, totally oblivious to the terrible things that were about to happen to me. I was the first child in our family. My brother came 3.5 years afterwards, and after that we decided no more children.
My name is Manfred Korman. My Hebrew name is Tzvi Elimelech. And I was born on December 21, 1931. And I was definitely the younger of the two children.
And where were you born?
Hamburg, Germany.
And Gerd, you were also born in Hamburg?
No, no. I was born in a town in the Rhineland. The name of the town at the time was Elberfeld. Over the years it tended to change and it's now called Wuppertal. It's a town not far from Düsseldorf, not far from Cologne, and it's a town made famous by Karl Marx and his buddy, because the buddy, whose name I'm blocking on, the buddy was a local. He was the son of a textile owner, and Elberfeld was known as a textile town, an important town in the valley of the Rhine.
So the Nazis didn't come to power until 1933. Could you describe your childhood, your pre-Nazi childhood in Germany, pre-war? What kind of childhood did you have before the Nazis came to power?
Well,
you were
being born at the end of December 31, I was maybe a year and a half old when Adolf Hitler came to power. So my memory of government is not really very dramatic.
What about your life, though?
But my life was, we lived in an apartment that I remember in a part of Hamburg, Germany. And then we moved to the last address which we had in Germany, which was Behnstraße, which was not too far away from the synagogue, which was Bornplatz Synagogue, and the rabbi was Joseph Kalibach. But I remember nothing negative in terms of my early childhood experience in Hamburg. I remember sledding down the streets and things of that nature, playing in coal yards. I did all the things that a kid should or should not do. And I was a kindergarten youngster. Just a little while before we were deported, at the Bornplatz Synagogue.
And Gerd, what are your memories of being a small boy before the Nazis came to power? Describe your life.
Well,
and
I have
your parents.
I have to preface it because with the deportation, I was 10 at the point of the deportation, and I became quite conscious of having lost much of my memory before 10. I had little snippets, and over the years I've often wondered whether what I remember and don't remember was quite the same for everybody else, or whether my sense was really correct that I had my memory wiped out or affected profoundly by the deportation. So what I do remember is the same context that Manny was talking about, and I can best indicate it by telling you that by the time I was six, I had to ride the subways in order to go to school. And I remember quite clearly that on one of those trips, a uniformed SS man in a crowded subway put me on his lap with my books from the Talmud Torah Shule. In other words, Hebrew language texts. I was a young soccer player, so at any opportunity, I would go off to play soccer on a field near a railway station where we lived. I had no problems with the local population. I had no problems with anybody else. And I wasn't really conscious of having a specific problem, except I knew that we were not the same kind of German citizens as everybody else. I had a sense of that. You couldn't help but have a sense like that. And the reason for that was because my mother had a brother who was a Reichsbanner. The Reichsbanner was a militant wing of the Social Democratic Party. He was a Reichsbanner leader in Wuppertal, in Elberfeld. A street fighter against the Nazis, and in retrospect, a genuine hero. He was murdered in 1933 because he was a Reichsbanner. But everything that was said about him was he was a Jewish Reichsbanner. So as a child, I was very, very conscious of having lost an uncle to the Nazis, which is to say, unlike Manny, I had a much sharper sense of our circumstances.
By the way, the interesting thing about this uncle, he was memorialized in Elberfeld in the 1990s. And there's a plaque in the town of Elberfeld indicating that he was killed at this spot, this spot by the Nazis and so on and so forth. So there is memory of his life.
Was that the first time that you realized that the Nazi anti-Semitic ideology was posed a danger? Was that the first time you felt that the Nazi regime was posing a danger to you and the Jewish community?
I was not conscious of the Nazi danger until October 28, 1938, when they picked us up in the morning. And from that point on, our life was so dramatically changed that I knew that this is a whole new world. That for me, certainly was a distressing time. I don't have memories of how distressing it was, but a kid like I, who had a train running around the apartment, who had to leave that train, that was a major loss. Right? I mean, and it's interesting because the first thing I asked my mother when we saw her, when we came to the United States, I said to her, "Did you bring my trains?" Right? So that kind of gives you an idea of that importance.
Do you remember the details of that day?
I remember some of the detail. I remember having to leave. I remember being in jail. They separated mothers and children from fathers. They had taken us to the police station on that day, October 28, 38. It was a Friday, and they then put us on lorries. I don't remember that piece of it. I remember being at a police station, but that I remember the lorries. And then they took us to the Hamburg jail. And then that night, they then reunited us at the railroad station, and that's when we were shipped off to Poland.
Gerd, was your memory, what was your memory? Were you with Manny at the time when you were arrested?
I have to tell you, you know, a historian deals with memory. And I've been acutely aware of having a critical attitude towards my own memory. And what influences memory. So as I listen to Manny, I realize that what he says and what I say today is very likely influenced by what we have told each other since then over the years. And since I wrote a lot of this stuff down, by having a written account, which is another form of memory expression, that account itself has helped to affect our memories. So when he speaks of his memory, and when I speak of my memory, you have to appreciate that this is not pure memory being offered to the question. So what was the question?
What are your recollections about when the Nazis arrested you and your family?
I think the most dramatic thing that I now think about is how stunned I was by the policeman who came to the house to take us away. Because I had a very different impression of the policeman. As far as I was concerned, the policeman was my friend. I could trust him, and I did trust him. So when this particular policeman banged on the door and started shouting orders and commands, I suddenly realized I didn't know this policeman. And I think something in me probably suggested that I hadn't known the policeman at all.
What was condition, how long were you imprisoned before you were?
We were imprisoned for one day, October 28th, and then we were put on trains the night of October 28th, and the train left the Hamburg Railroad Station and then moved east to the Polish border.
And then what happened?
And then what happened? Yes. They took us off the trains. They stopped in the last town in Germany was Neubenschen. They took us off the trains, marched us to the border of no man's land, and right on the other side was Poland. The town at the other side turned out to be Szponjin. And there were many thousands of people who were coming in from different portions of Germany. We were from Hamburg, there were trains out of Frankfurt, there were trains out of Leipzig, if I recall correctly what I read. My memory, or my historical memory that my brother talks about, has that my father kind of kept us back from the crowd so we shouldn't be at the front. And then suddenly somebody ran across the border and we all ran to the other side. I think that's my memory.
Well, he's telescoped a lot. He's telescoped a lot. I've written in really significant detail about this whole episode. But I think the highlights of the deportation itself had a lot to do with the impact first of the prison, because I mean that really demonstrated to us something radically different was happening. And then when we first found each other on the railway platform, on the railway station, the two of us with my mother looking for my father in bedlam. I mean, veritable bedlam. And somehow we found ourselves. We found out each of us found each other. And then we didn't quite know what was going to happen next. Neither did anybody else. But we did, through our parents, have a sense we are being shipped east. And the reason we knew we were being shipped east is because we were Polish Jews. We weren't German Jews, we were Polish Jews. And in Germany, being a Polish Jew was something quite significant. It was significant in your passports, it was significant in the attitude of German Jewish families towards Polish Jewish families. It was significant. And so in that context, my parents knew being shipped to the East was a standard procedure of German governments for decades and decades and decades in the past. In Yiddish, there used to be an expression, "I'll ship you to the border," a mother would say to a child, a teacher would say to a student, or even a doctor would say to a patient, if you really don't shape up and behave yourself. So it was a natural assumption. If the government arrested you and you're at a railway station, you were headed back to Poland or Russia, whatever. So that was the drama of the railway station. And then there was the drama of little acts of heroism, because we ended up on a train. This was a prison train. It was a sealed train. Windows open a little bit from the top. So you move through these passenger cars, and suddenly a relative of ours reminded us and everybody else it was Shabbat. It was Friday night. So he stood there, obviously in dramatic protest. He stood there in his place with a Kiddush cup while passengers were coming through. And when my father saw him, he stopped. And he stopped the whole line behind him. And there was Ades, our relative, and we making Kiddush for Shabbat in the circumstances that the Germans were structuring for us. Very significant moment, I'm sure, for others in the line as well. And then there were dramatic moments of a different kind, still on the train, because the windows were down by about 3-4 inches, and suddenly these hands came through with oranges, because the German Jews had suddenly discovered us. We were now all in the same boat, and they were there bringing oranges and everything else. so that we would have something along the way. And then the trains took off. So even before the train came to the end station for us, this was a very traumatic experience, very traumatic.
How long did it take you to get to Poland across Germany?
A Saturday morning, if I'm not mistaken.
5 o'clock.
We were in at the border, at the Neubenschen border, when they took us off the trains.
Right.
And then they marched us to the border. And of course, there were Germans pushing us from the back, and the Poles were in the front. And
but every part of that encounter had its own context, every part. We ended up at the border, and then the German soldiers had to organize us on the platform. They had taken all the papers away initially when we were first imprisoned. So they called each person for whom they had a passport. So my father had to leave us and walk along what to me seemed like a long railway platform. But my eyes were then pretty good. So, and I'm sure Manny saw the same thing, except maybe it didn't register quite the same way. And I saw him going towards the soldiers at the end of the platform. But I wasn't noticing the soldiers so much as I was noticing the shiny black boots that one of them wore. And at that moment, and to this day, I've often wondered whether I made this up later or I really did feel it at the time. I'm convinced I felt it at the time. I suddenly realized that my father has lost control over me because he wasn't going to command me right or left, forward or backwards. That guy with the black boots was going to have all that control. So as a 10-year-old, that moment suddenly differentiated a lot, even though I still remembered that we had struggled, he and I, to find the Shabbos cake that my mother had always hidden in the closet every Friday after she baked the cake.
Actually, it was on top of the closet, and we had to climb up and get it.
Manny, you mentioned that at some point you made a run to the border back across into Germany.
We made a run. Everybody ran.
So no, first.
Let's tell this in detail. This is really riveting. So they were lining you up on the platform, and how did it happen?
And then marched us to the border.
Okay.
Right.
So at the border.
I see.
When Germans were back of us. The game plan was get us to the other side.
Manny, you get to the border too quickly.
I know that. I travel faster than you do. But at the border, since the question was back and forth, We didn't come back to the German border. It was all one way.
Towards Poland.
Always one way.
Okay.
Yeah.
So describe that. What happened at that point?
Well, after they did all the paper screening on the railway platform, we were directed to walk in the direction that they wanted us to walk. I don't think most of us had any idea where we were going. The assumption was we were walking to the frontier, but most of us had no idea A, what the frontier meant, and B, where it was. So from a 10-year-old perspective, there was this long line of people carrying everything, bedding, suitcases, babies, all struggling to move forward. I wrote some letters right afterwards to my parents. I said, this must have been like the exodus from Egypt, because you saw this long line of people going in the same direction and having to carry everything out with them. Sometimes I would see a soldier who was accompanying us laughing, sometimes not laughing. Sometimes there were people, locals, who stood by the side, just looked, or they were laughing. And then we came to this point that Manny talks about. We really came to the frontier. And many of us now learned what no man's land was. Because the frontier has a railway-like guard that goes up and down just like a railway, guard. So the railway guard lifted, and we stepped into what was no man's land. You know, the rumor factory among the people who were doing all this made sure everybody knew we were in no man's land. For the German soldiers, it meant a complete redeployment, because while we were walking, they were walking alongside of us, guarding us, obviously. Once we got into no man's land, they redeployed. So it turned out that there were machine gun units and there were rifle units with fixed bayonets. And again, what Manny remembers is that as we started to move, some of us were in the front, some of us in the middle, some in the back. My father kept on telling us, as Manny said, stay back, stay back. In retrospect, I realized that his training as a soldier in World War I was coming alive. So stay back, because he was afraid there would be Polish soldiers on the other side. And if they started to shoot at each other, it was better to be on one side than in the middle. So we were really quite far back, because I don't know if Manny remembers it, but I do remember the bayonet was almost touching me. And again, like in all these other situations since the deportation started, we had no idea what was going to happen next and what was going to happen after next. No idea. And then, out of the clear blue, everybody fell down. Face down. My father telling us to take the suitcases, pile them up in front of us. And there we were for a second. I don't know how long it really was. And suddenly, I mean really suddenly, there were three shots. And if you're lying down, having just been pushed over the border, and you hear three shots, you know it's not a backfire from a car. And, you know, you're petrified. But we could see ahead of us. And just as suddenly as we heard the shots, we saw one man get up and just run for it. So we all ran with it. We just followed him. If the Polish soldier had any idea of stopping us some other way, they were completely overwhelmed. But they made no effort. So we ended up on the other side of no man's land, meaning in the Polish side. Completely exhausted, completely petrified, totally ignorant of what was going to happen next.
And what did happen next?
Pardon?
What did happen next? What happened?
What happened next?
Do you remember what happened next?
All I remember is where we ended up finally, which was in the horse stables.
Right.
Because nobody knew what to do with us. I mean, talking about, we didn't know where we were going. They didn't know we were coming either. And the Poles took horses out of stables and they put humans into those stables. So there was on the straw on the floor, if I recall correctly. And there were people from other towns whom we met. I remember.
Did the owners of the stable, the home, the barn that you were housed in or protected, did they know you were Jewish?
I have no idea.
What was the question?
The people who were in the stable, who owned the stables, did they know that we were Jewish? Or were they military stables?
Right, they were army
military
barracks.
Stables.
They were army barracks.
Army barracks.
At the time, we didn't know what it was. But just as Manny describes, we were lying down, and then the next activity around us came horse-drawn carriages, single guys. And my father sees them coming and immediately says, don't give them anything. Don't give them anything. There were people from the town who had heard about the deportation. They were coming, and they were ready to take the loot. And while this little episode is happening, we start seeing these horses Manny was talking about. The horses were coming towards us, and we followed their droppings into the stable. I assume they were military stable, police stable.
Yeah,
and that entry into the stables was the beginning of our refugee life for the next year. Because first came the stable for 3 nights. And that was an extraordinary experience for everybody. For everybody.
What were conditions with hunger? What were conditions in the stable for the time you were there? What were the conditions like?
Right. People, there were straw sacks that the horses had used. So we used the straw sacks.
That's right.
And as he said, we met people, relatives, friends. So you shared what you had. And what we had was a pot, a small pot. This pot had to serve for everything liquid. Everything liquid, including food. One of the sources of other kinds of food, you know, besides stuff that went into the pot, and I don't remember now what went into the pot, came from the Joint Distribution Committee. Because from the moment the deportation began, the Joint Distribution Committee became aware of it. And they had a main office in Warsaw. So as soon as we arrived in Spungen, the Joint sent its people up. And that meant we had a connection to a food supply and medical supply. There was no food supply, so far as I know, from the Polish government, nor was there medical supply from the Polish government. But the Joint did send people, and some of the Joint people would talk and give speeches. I remember there was a big hoopla when a baby was born, close to midnight. But it was a very tense situation because people like my mother and father were aware that the Polish government was not cooperating with the Germans in this enterprise. So my mother was not a German-born, a Polish-born person. My father was a Polish-born person, and therefore he was a kind of Polish citizen. The reason we were deported is because he had been born in Poland, but my mother was not. And rumor very quickly flew around that people who were not born in Poland were going to get organized and sent back. So my mother had to figure out a way for a few days how to move around. So she was always moving around, wherever we were, including moving around in the local railway station. Anyway, she managed not to get arrested. And after three, so we had food supply, and it came, you know, it was delivered with extraordinary waiters and fineries, great sensitivity, except this was all masked. Because trucks would come.
And they threw it off the trucks.
Would come with loaves of, comes with loaves of bread, and they would have butter urns. And there were two men on top. One was driving, two men on top. And they would take the loaf of bread, smash it on the side of the truck. I mean, elegantly, because the half that fell off fell into the truck, but didn't fall off most of the time. And then they would take the half that they still had, slam the butter on top of it, and then they threw it over the side where people like me, I don't know if many came to catch, but I went to catch. People like me had to catch it and deliver it back to the family. There were probably other sources of food, but I don't remember them. And after, at the end of 3 days, this refugee camp took a different kind of shape, because the people in town, there were some Jews in town, opened their homes, that is, they opened their floors, where many of us slept. He and I and other kids slept on the floor. Somebody found a cover and put a cover on. My mother, she still was circulating somewhere. And my father had somehow found a different place to stay. And after some weeks or days of this sort of experience, we were moved into much more elegant quarters. The local government made an abandoned flour mill available to us, an unheated flour mill into which the committee piled beds and that sort of thing. And we were in that mill for, I guess, something like 3 months. My father still had that space somewhere else.
In the Shoichet's house.
I guess so.
Yeah, he had a room in the Shoichet's house.
Right.
You know what a Shoichet is? A guy who...
A butcher.
Who
slaughterer.
Slaughters chickens and has rabbinical kind of, okay, does it in a certain way. That's whose house he was living in. Then after the 3 months he's talking about, my father was able to finally get us out of there. He rented a room in a little town right outside of Shpanjin called Nonya on a farm. He rented one room, and the family lived in this one room, which happened to be right by the waterfront, and we lived there.
So this is now February, March of 39?
We're now to 39. Sure.
And probably later.
How long before the
November,
Nazi
December,
invasion,
January.
The full Nazi invasion of Poland?
A few months.
A few months. You were just before.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
When we get to it, you'll be amazed.
Yeah.
When our Kindertransport left Poland.
It's almost 3 o'clock. It's almost
3 o'clock. 5 to 3.
So,
oh,
I don't want to rush you because this is fascinating. It just goes to show how lucky you have to be to survive the Holocaust. And you know, I'm thinking of the timeline here, and it's amazing.
We're just at the beginning of the trip.
I know. What would you like to do in terms of time now?
We have 20 minutes to go.
Okay. So I do want to leave 10 minutes for reflection and your thoughts about, in terms of a historical perspective, or your thoughts about current political, or your comparisons to what you think now versus then. Carry us forward in your story here in terms of the 3 months that you spent at the kosher butcher.
My father spent.
And he was at
and
the kosher
butcher. We remained in this place called Die Mühle.
Okay.
And then after the 3 month period, my father was able to rent this room and get us out of this Die Mühle, and we lived together in this one room on this farm. It was in April, I'm pushing a little ahead here, in April of 39, in fact it was Passover, the intermediate days, right after the first 2 days, my father was, and I think everybody who had been pushed out could go back to Germany, a representative could go back to Germany and take care of the households. And so my father left us in April of 39 to go back to Germany to take care of a household, that policeman came, we locked the door, there was a car in the garage, there was an apartment with all kinds of stuff, and I'm sure there were bank accounts. I don't know enough about that piece. So my father left us, anticipating to return, and while in Hamburg, a friend of his sent a visa which would take him to Cuba. You want to pick up the story from there?
No, but you're doing fine. But in the Nightmare's fairy tale, you can pick up all the in-between pieces. Because we really spell them out. Which in-between pieces?
So I'll take it. So my father and mother somehow communicated in terms of should he return to Poland or should he leave. He had this visa. The decision was made that he's leaving, and he ends up on the ship to St. Louis. Everybody who has some knowledge about the ship of St. Louis knows what happened to that ship. So my father took that ship, went to Cuba. Cuba wouldn't let the ship in. I think they permitted 22 people off. And then that ship returned. I mean, it left in May of 39 from Hamburg and landed in end of June 39 in Belgium, because the captain of the ship did not want to take the people back to Germany because he kind of anticipated what could happen to them. And so the decision was made, the people would be distributed among Belgium, France, Holland, and England. And that's what happened. Our father ended up in Holland. And there's a whole history then in terms of what happened to him. When the Germans came into the lowlands, he ended up interned in Camp Westerbork, which was a shipping camp to Auschwitz and Bergen-Belsen. But he never left there. You want to pick it up from here?
We were put on a Kindertransport in Spongen. Complicated how we got onto this particular Kindertransport, but we got on it. And that meant we had to go to a rendezvous center right outside Warsaw, where we were mixed with something like 100 other children. We were there waiting for families in England to offer to take us in. And the transport people didn't want to leave Poland until they had housing for all the children. But now a race was beginning. Otwock was near Warsaw, and Warsaw was some distance away from Danzig.
Just a minute, the Otwock is the little town that they collected us in.
And Danzig was a major port on the Baltic, had been for decades, played an important role in the armistice talks of World War I. But a few days before end of August, the German government made overtures about Danzig. So while we were in Otwock, waiting for the people in England to find a place for all of us, with my father already gone, and by now my mother gone too, because she went back to Germany to try to get a visa to go to the United States. Meaning that we too, with some 98 other children, were sitting in Otwock in a very precarious position. I mean, in hindsight, you have to put the alternatives front and center. Otwock was a suburb of Warsaw. Within 3 weeks after the invasion, Warsaw is under German domination. That means people in Otwock were under German domination. That means these two guys and everything else had come directly under German domination, and we were probably perfect candidates for whatever Aryanization program they had in mind. So it's that kind of a context within which we end up on the Warsaw railway station, which means we were at the Warsaw railway station on the first day of Poland's mobilization for war. Right? Right.
August 24, August 25, somewhere like that.
So Poland's mobilizing, and we're coming into the station. We, who's we? He and I, all these other kids, and one other boy. His name was Joseph Camille. He was also with us, although we weren't too friendly yet. We're coming into the railway station of Warsaw, and we didn't know that the mother of this Joseph had suddenly rushed from Spongin to get her child off whatever train was headed away, because the mother was an Aguda lady. The people who were deported from Germany were a mixed group, secular, religious, and God knows what. She was one of the ultra-Orthodox women. And she suddenly realized her only son was going into nowhere, into Christian land. She had to get him back. So she was in the railway station, not to wave goodbye to her son, but to take her son off the train, if he was already on it. And that information became public very quickly in the station, and she found herself surrounded by mothers. Take my child, I'll take yours. Let's switch. I'm not making up this story. She told me this story. So when all these other mothers came rushing towards her, she finally realized what the stakes were. She left Joseph on the train. So the three of us, with everybody else, by train, on a troop train already, headed for Gdynia, the Polish port. And there, without interruption of pace or lunch breaks or anything of that sort, we were marched directly from the train to the ship, because the German cruisers had already arrived in Danzig, and it was a touch-and-go business for the ship to leave. But it left. But it couldn't go to England the usual way. It had to go the long way. The usual way was to go through the Kiel Canal. But the Germans had closed the Kiel Canal. So this ship had to go via Denmark and Sweden.
Over the North Sea?
And make its way into England.
Sure.
So we arrived in England a few days before the outbreak of
August
war.
August 28 or right. 29.
But unbeknownst to us, we had the great, great privilege of being met by the father of the heroine of the TV series Murder, She Wrote.
Angela Lansbury.
Right, because Lansbury,
hold on a second. What?
Lansbury was head of the Labour Party.
Angela Lansbury's father?
Yep. And he met us. I was totally oblivious to it. I learned about it afterwards. And from there, we were redistributed, finally ended up with an evacuee group in Devonshire.
Well, we were first distributed into London.
Right.
Into Jewish families. And then war broke out. And the British government, approximately 10 days later, said all children of London will be evacuated out to the countryside, afraid of
the bombings.
Yeah. So we were all sent out. We ended up in a town called Tulloch. Definitely a Christian environment, and in our case, the people who took us in were just super. They took five people, two girls, Joseph, myself, and my brother. That's where we lived for the time until we left England to come to the United States.
What was your worry about your parents? Could you describe what your concern and worry, or what was your state of mind with worry about your family who were back in Germany?
It's a good question. And I can answer it quite explicitly, but I have no idea how reliable.
Wait, 1 minute. My parents were no longer in Germany.
On the other side of the English Channel.
On the other side of the English Channel. Now we're talking.
Right. So, war broke out, right? Which meant Germany was at war with England. Right? Right. Germany was at war with England. That means the mail was cut. My mother initially was still in Germany. She didn't leave for the United States until the spring of 1940. So while she was in Germany, we couldn't write to her. But I could write to my father in Holland. So on the basis of what I wrote in those letters, I have to answer your question by saying I was a master of suppression. Master of suppression. The letters are full of the performa, things that a child said. How are you? I hope you're well. I was very concerned about not having soccer boots. And I thought maybe he could send me soccer boots. I wanted to know how my mother was. But there's no anguish in those letters. There's no, my God, what's happening to us? No. The letters are from a youngster who's absolutely convinced that somewhere along the way, this is all going to end and we'll all come together again. And yet, I know that I knew that wasn't the case. I really knew it wasn't the case. But, so you live with the awareness of the ultimate horror. But it's not ever present in an active way. It's the same kind of experience, I'm sure, that many youngsters have when their parents, for one reason or another, are separated and go away. And
well, after the war, I mean, were you able to learn what happened to the rest of your family?
To whose family?
Our family?
Yes.
My grandparents and things like that?
All of it.
He's done some real research, this guy over here. We certainly found out that our grandmother and grandfather from my mother's side were shipped out from Elberfeld. In fact, my brother had made contact with the curator, I guess it's the curator of there's a center in Elberfeld. Wuppertal, and they have records of exactly where our grandparents ended up, and they were certainly killed
They died in Lodz.
In Lodz, right. The Lodz ghetto, right? And my father's parents, they lived in Poland, and I never really knew.
They died in Lemberg.
In Lemberg, which was the town that they lived in. And very Orthodox Jews. But their children came out. Some of their children came out.
And the brother, his brother, one of his brothers, ended up in Siberia and came back. And ended up in Israel.
In Israel.
We have a few minutes left if you want to keep your deadline here.
Yes.
When did you immigrate to the United States? How did that happen? And did you rendezvous with your mother? Take us from England to the United States.
So our mother arrived here first.
First?
She came, she was in Germany with her parents, went to see her parents, and then made was able to finally make arrangements and get a visa, which took some doing, to come to the United States. She wangled her way out of Germany into Genoa, Italy, and she was able to take a ship from Genoa, Italy, a United States ship, and came to the United States. So she arrived, I think she celebrated Passover of 1940 on board the ship. So she was the first to arrive. And then our uncle, who was in the British Army as a result of, he came from Germany, my mother's brother, and ended up in England. And to get off the Isle of Man, I guess it was, they collected these people in the Isle of Man. And one of the ways to get out of the Isle of Man was to become a, to join the military. And so he joined the army, and they changed his name from Zally Laufer to John Lawson. And, you know, they anglicized him. And he came to see us after he fought in Dunkirk and Calais in Devonshire. And then we got visas. He had something to do with that, I think, and got visas to come to the United States. And so we were on the ship, the Cameronia. We came to the States. The ship in back of us was sunk. The ship in front of us was sunk, and we came to the States.
U-boats.
And Cameronia then finally was U-boat. I think it was destroyed
on the way back
on another trip. So we came to the States, and then we met my mother. And then there's a whole nother living in the United States, what that was all about. I think that's our time, if we wanted to stick to time.
One last question.
Go ahead.
What message, if any, would you like to leave people who are watching this video? Is there a message that you want to communicate?
Well, for us, it's the fact that the miracle of survival, and all four of us survived. My father arrived here in 1946. He left a child of 7 and 10, and he wound up with a child of 15 and 18. He came back interesting boy. And I mean, I always feel today it was such a lucky situation that we became a family again, because the concept in my head of had we not become a family again, what in hell would have happened to us in terms of our growing up, and would we have achieved what we've achieved in our lifetime? Being a family unit for me, absolutely, at least I think, proved that that structure gave me the opportunity, and I think gave my brother the opportunity to achieve what we've done.
I think you were all very brave, all four of you.
Brave?
All, you were all very brave. Ah. Maybe the older brother especially.
Oh. Well, without him, I wouldn't have made it.
I know. I can feel that.
Oh, my God, yes.
But you asked what...
Yes.
What one thinks in retrospect. I come away with two thoughts. One is the extraordinary courage of my parents. I mean, in retrospect, what the kinds of decisions they made I don't think I could make as a parent myself. To send both children into the blue, I find it extraordinary. And they were both people of faith. They were not ultra-Orthodox. They were somewhere conservative-type Jews. But they were profound believers in God. And that faith must have somehow carried them. But they were also very practical. So obviously, without their courage, the story wouldn't have taken place. And the other that I've really thought about quite often is how fortunate I was in having him along. Because the two of us were able to maintain a bond to the family life that we were supposed to have. And we had to experience all kinds of things where the internal association with that bond made all the difference in the world. Made all the difference in the world. Because there were many places, especially once we came to the United States, where we could have taken radically different turns. Radically different. So we were boarded out for a good portion of the early years. And we were boarded out in East New York, Brooklyn, which was a lower middle class neighborhood. And we had options. I think we had options. But that bond that we had meant that one look from my mother's eyes when she came to visit from her job in Great Neck, New York, was enough to prevent us from doing the wrong things. And if each one of us had been alone, I don't think that bond would have worked. So those are the two main personal
gotta go, guy.
Conclusions.
Thank you very much.